something to do about myself. Because we are talking about sharing our humanity, uprooted, and status. So I teach at the Naval Postgraduate School, this place here in Monterey, California, and I teach students who are military officers, junior officers, and oftentimes they're very good at breaking things, breaking countries. They're not so good at putting them back together, so they always want to know about how do you put together a country again? How do you rebuild a nation? And I have to tell them that it's not as easy as doing, you know, a checklist of A to Z, that it's not going to be like an architectural plan for rebuilding a house. Even if they try to map out all the relationships between the insurgency and the government and the people, for example, the work that they do is a lot more like gardening as a metaphor than anything else. So in gardening, the weather changes. You might need to prune something, but you never have really control over what happens. So it's really about the illusion of control. And I tell them that gardeners have no illusion of control. We create the right growing conditions, nurture a healthy soil life, set up our lifestyle so we have time to tend to our crops, and we plant a diverse variety of sturdy, healthy plants and watch them grow. We adjust, we go along, removing excess weeds, mulching water, fertilizing when necessary, and picking up pests. But ultimately, the end result almost always includes crop failures and unexpected successes. And we feel more like stewards, sometimes even observers, and that's more of a domain. So that's really the message I want to give to you starting off. And of course, I'm much better at doing this with my clients than anything else. Last year, there was a piece in The Economist, and the opening of that piece was no less than the act itself, the politics of genocide can be heartbreaking. Me, and it's really going to be a presentation that talks a bit about genocide and the consequences of genocide on refugees and displaced persons, lifelong families. So I'm probably a young local leader in the World Economic Forum, a member of the Council on Foreign Relations, but you know, I really am not all that different from you. I could never have imagined that back in 1990 I was really here in the anime club, right? Slides aren't coming up, but I was just like you, basically, a high school student dreaming of a diploma, not a fancy diploma, I couldn't afford that, but I was taking the SAT, doing AP exams, and taking exams, and getting a lot of wrong answers. I was spared, however, the area knowledge. So how did I get to where I am? How did I become who I am? I'll give you a talk in six acts from refugee to teacher. I know it says five, but I added a sixth one in the meantime. A few years ago, I gave a talk at Penn about escaping the Khmer Rouge. And it was about my family story, story of our escape from the killing fields and what my mother did to save us. And the great thing about that talk was that she was there in the audience at the end. I got a standing ovation, and my wife, 8 months pregnant at the time, was also there in the audience along with some very important people. I had the feeling that, you know, it might be the last trip I get to make with my mother because she was getting older, and she was getting sicker, and 7 months later she passed away. So that gave me the chance to think about the legacy and things she left behind, lessons learned from her life. So let me talk about my own story. So Act 1, Cambodia. And here, my parents in 1969 in Phnom Penh, we lived in the city in a house right there, courtesy of Google Maps. 10 families are now living in that house. I don't know any of them. They're not related to us. They came back in after the Civil War and took over the property. The city itself, Phnom Penh, was a beautiful city architecturally. And movies like The Little Prince played there. But across the world, President Nixon was going to Cambodia, and he had this to say about Cambodia. There are no American combat troops in Cambodia. There are no American combat advisors in Cambodia. There will be no American combat troops or advisors in Cambodia who will aid Cambodia. Cambodia is the Nixon Doctrine in its purest form. That's in November 71. And of course, what this meant was that B-52s were going to do the job. And they dropped their payload, and half of the country was bombed in smithereens, basically about five times Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And what that led to, of course, was that in April 17, 1975, the downtown capital fell. Actually, people were quite happy then because they thought that the Khmer Rouge, the communist guerrillas, were coming, and it couldn't get any worse than it had been for the last 5 years. The war had really already taken such a toll. Peace was going to finally fall upon the country, but the young people who marched into Phnom Penh were young people like yourselves, really, your age, carrying mortar rounds. And of course the violence began, and they proceeded to evacuate a city of 2 million in 3 days, including my family. So you can see this exodus of people leaving the city, sent to all over the countryside. The leaders of the Khmer Rouge were Pol Pot and his minions here in this picture from David. And I'm not able to do justice to what happened there except to give you this quote here from Michael Paterny. Essentially, once upon a time, there was a regime so evil that it created an anti-society where torture was currency and music, books, and love were abolished. This regime ruled for 4 years and murdered nearly 2 million of its citizens, a quarter of the population. Now, a quarter of the population, 2 million. Doesn't make sense. That's 1 in 4 people, right? So let me bring it down a notch to a place called Tul Slang, the torture center slash prison that used to be a school. Can you just imagine like your school being turned into a torture center? I mean, maybe you feel it's a torture center now. Up to 16,000 people died there, and behind barbed wire was in classrooms turned into torture chambers with beds and medieval devices. Mothers, their infants here in the arms being killed. Babies, boys, girls. He's not even a teenager. She's probably 10 years old. Buried in killing fields. Now, at this same time, my parents and I and my 4 siblings were in a province called Persat. We've been sent over there to work the fields. And it's late 75, close to sunset, and they're coming back from working the rice fields, 4 slaves, really slaves. And the Khmer Rouge called a meeting in which they say that Vietnamese citizens can return to Vietnam. And my mom spoke some Vietnamese, so she decided to pretend to be Vietnamese, and my dad agreed. And on the 3rd day of our journey, actually, towards Vietnam, when we're starting the journey, we don't know yet what's going to happen. My father, who's been sick with dysentery and malnutrition, dies. So we start this journey to Vietnam, and actually he didn't speak Vietnamese, so he would have been a problem. But we start our journey towards Vietnam, and the only thing that they care about is not a passport. We don't have passports anymore at this time. It's language. And to fit the role, my mom had given all the children new names, Vietnamese names. So the Vietnamese was really bad, so she'd given all the girls boys' names and all the boys' girls' names. And it wasn't until a lady, a Vietnamese lady, who was also taking in the same camp, told her about this, that she figured out, okay, because she had switched all the names. And she tutored her for 3 days. So she was the first of many good Americans who met us along the way. And after this tutoring, my mom passed the exam, and we were able to go to Vietnam, 4 siblings and I, my mother. And here we are in 1978. Mom is quite thin. We had an aunt and an uncle in Vietnam who helped us. Here I am. And for my mom, it wasn't good enough for us to just be free and to have the safety of Vietnam. We needed to get to a developed country. Vietnam had become communist by then. Our opportunities would be limited. She was smart enough, however, to once upon arrival to Vietnam to say that we weren't Vietnamese, that we were in fact Cambodians. And so being Cambodians, you could leave Vietnam if another country accepted you. And at the time, the only country that could take people out of Vietnam was France. And we have some distant relatives in France, but nobody with the same last name. But a Frenchman, a chain-smoking Frenchman, very stereotypical, helped us and found a family, found a woman, probably from the phone book, with the same last name as my mother's, and convinced her to sign the papers. And those papers got lost, but he didn't care. He just forged her signature and jumped over the fence at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and got them processed before closing time. So my sister and I and the rest of the family get to visits and decides that he should move to the U.S. The aunt, this is an aunt that lives in California. So she gets us plane tickets, and off we go in October 85 to be settled in America. And to a new life in America, one that isn't necessarily filled with milk and honey. We have to, you know, live in pretty poor conditions. We rent a house here in Oakland, California. Our businesses are rather poor and threadbare. My mother works in a garment factory. We live on food stamps, and I go to junior high school at Willard Junior High School in Berkeley, California, where we're borrowing an address to get me to better schools, basically. And at the time, I'm taking English as a second language, and I have to decide to, you know, to take courses in ninth grade at the high school. So Berkeley High School is the high school, and I go to the cafeteria here and start taking courses, and I meet a tutor from Willard who decides to give me some advice. She looks at the schedule and says, well, you're taking ESL again for high school. You really should stop taking ESL. You should take, you know, 4 years of English because you'll be ready for the A through G requirements of the University of California, Cal State University. So this tutor is really a good Samaritan by giving me this advice. And it takes a lot of effort because my mom has to come to Berkeley High School to sign me out of ESL. And that happens. Maybe she would have been busy one day and could have done it, but she did it. And at 16, I start, the Good Samaritan tells me, at 16, I finished high school and started UC Berkeley and have a wonderful time. It's a great place of learning. They say that if you're bored with Berkeley, you're bored with life. And I meet a woman named Wardell, who is an administrator at Princeton University, where she convinces me that I can do graduate studies on the East Coast, live away from my family. And so at 20, I start my master's at Princeton, and it's an amazing experience. But the point here is really one that Good Samaritans have really been all over my life. The people who've given me help and sympathy. And that really, I'm not here by myself. This room is full of Good Samaritans, and behind me, in fact, are all the people on whose shoulders I stand. Now, this lesson can apply to you as well. We can all be Good Samaritans to others. Kennedy said that to those who much is given, much is expected. So let me move now to the world and how I try to have an impact on the world. After Princeton, I went to work for the World Bank for 3 years as a consultant, working on the Middle East and North Africa, going to Algeria, West Bank and Gaza. I worked on Cambodia, trying to fight poverty. I did have my fun at the time they got me on the Concorde, but you know, it's just one of those perks, but the rest of the work is really meaningful. I went back to college, back to my alma mater, Berkeley, to do 3 more degrees, MSM, a PhD, and then worked for the UN Development Program in East Timor, which was the world's newest country. I mean, what a chance to make a difference in the World Bank. Mark Brown, who was a vice president at the World Bank and who headed UNDP, had this to say: there's no more noble endeavor than the fight for social and global justice and for peace and development. And it's something that I teach to my students. I mean, we talk about the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, for example, about its preamble. All human beings are born free and equal in dignity. They're endowed with reason and conscience and should act towards one another in a spirit of brotherhood. This is about rights and responsibilities, right? This is about how I'm having a little problem with my PowerPoint. What else has to happen at this moment? At least it's not a wardrobe malfunction. Rights and responsibilities. And so at the Naval Special School, I talk about the responsibility to protect. How many of you have heard about R2P? No one. Okay, so the responsibility to protect is this international human rights norm that says that just because you're a country, just because you're a nation state, you don't have the right to abuse your citizens. You don't have the right to commit genocide, war crimes, ethnic cleansing, and crimes against humanity within your borders. But so, you know, other countries should be able to intervene. But we know that, you know, the UN, the body that upholds this, is its Secretary General, Ban Ki-moon, you know, too often fails to protect citizens from their own governments. And that when we talk about never again, we always see again and again. So, for example, in the Holocaust, where 11 to 17 million people died, not just Jews, but Romans and homosexuals. And in Rwanda, where another 800,000 to 1 million Rwandans died, I mean, the Tutsis at the hands of the Hutus, right? And in Bosnia, the first genocide in Europe since World War II, 200,000 plus died. I mean, I'm probably too young to remember this image, but I remember it certainly. The camps in Srebrenica, 8,000 men and boys were killed. And most recently in Darfur, where 300,000 plus have died at the hands of the Janjaweed. So let me now turn back to Cambodia and to talk about a little bit about my book, Aid Dependence in Cambodia, A Foreign Assistance Undermines Democracy. And I pick up the story of my family there, and I go into sort of what happens in Cambodia after the Khmer Rouge. So Vietnam invades Cambodia in 1979. And it's liberation one thing, but actually they occupied for 10 years, Cambodia. And it isn't until October of 1991 that the agreements on a comprehensive political settlement of the Cambodian conflict, also known as the Paris Peace Accords, is signed. And that's the first time that all sides of the conflict come together and agree to basically stop fighting one another. And the UN comes to Cambodia in 1992 in a mission, largest peacekeeping mission at the time, $2 billion, called the United Nations Transitional Authority in Cambodia. But some of the memories from that time, and certainly the ones that are portrayed now from Cambodian to half museums, are these. Basically, what do you think is happening in this picture here? Your slide. What's happening in that picture? Right, right. It's a brothel. There's a karaoke club. A peacekeeper with a commercial sex worker, if at that. And the head of the UN mission at the time, Yasushi Akashi, special representative for the Secretary General, he heard complaints about his peacekeepers maybe spreading AIDS in Cambodia, said that boys will be boys. And the first time that he faced an obstacle in terms of his work was when he tried to go into an area controlled by the Khmer Rouge in 1992, and there was a bamboo pole in front of the car. And instead of saying, raise this bamboo pole so I can go meet who I want to meet, he stopped there. And that showed his hand in terms of the UN's willingness to really stand up for the principles of the agreement. And so in 1993, this man here gets the most votes. He's a royalist named Norodom Ratanawat. But he has to share power with this man here, Hun Sen, who has been prime minister since 1985. So they have a setup where they have two prime ministers. The first prime minister and the second prime minister. And they have equal powers. And you can imagine how having two heads in one country leads to conflict. Because in 1997, Hun Sen launched the coup that deposes Ratanawat. So let's fast forward to 2000 and 2010 and what happens in Cambodia in the period in the intervening years, a couple of $1 billion later. Cambodia now, according to the analysis I've done in my book, has the following situation. From 2002 to 2010, the average government spending in Cambodia, say if it was $1, Cambodia received 94.3 cents in foreign aid. So as you can imagine, this didn't have a very good incentive on taxation. So the amount of taxes Cambodia collects is low, too low to develop. And where does the money in fact go? Difference is really the corruption money that $300 to $500 million is basically mid-2000s estimated to go into the hands of authorities from companies. And at the same time, what happens to democracy? Because you can imagine that if people aren't paying taxes or as much taxes as they should, they are not holding their government accountable. So the trends on governance and democracy aren't very good. You can see that the only thing that goes up is this sort of red dotted line here, political stability. And the reason for that is simple. The same man has been in charge of Cambodia since 1985. He's in this black box here, and his in-laws are all over the place. They're the ones who are running different ministries, powerful ministries like defense and the police. So let me get, this is all very macro when doesn't make that much sense, but let's talk instead about a real example of rule of law and how damaged by dominant interference or dominant presence. So there's a place called Bangkok Lake, which is in the middle of Thailand, where 20,000 people live around this lake. And it's a really sad story because this lake here is a beautiful gem in the middle of the city of Thailand. I would go there and have a drink in the evenings at sunset. The lake was a fresh piece of area that could allow, when it rained a lot, waters to go into. So it got purchased by a private company and filled with mud from the river next door. But the way they did it was to basically pump in mud from the river, and the houses around the lake were essentially flooded. The properties became uninhabitable. People had to move. And what were people offered as a result of this? Some of them got $7,500 when their properties were worth $100,000, because it's a very valuable piece of real estate. And how were donors at all involved in this? Did they do anything? Well, the World Bank had a land titling project in Cambodia to essentially give land titles to people living in the country. But they were tricked by the authorities into not giving land titles to these people. So that's why they're now protesting. And the bank has been found essentially to have violated its own principles, and it's no longer doing new lending in Cambodia. But the end result is violence, of course, against the people of Cambodia. Protests being met with police batons. Now let me refer you now to another case, the case of the Khmer Rouge tribunal. So, the Khmer Rouge are no longer in power, but justice has to be meted out. And the idea that Western donors had was, let's do something called norm penetration. Let's show the Cambodians how justice is done, right? Let's show them the way a trial can be done. So they took this man here, the head of Tuol Sleng, that prison, torture center that killed 16,000 people. And the man's name was Duc. He confessed in 2009 to essentially committing to being the director and to heading this prison. And Duc was found guilty in 2011. He was found guilty of the deaths of 12,273 people. And he was sentenced to originally 35 years, reduced to 19 for the time already served. Right? So he actually appealed that because he thought it was too long. And his the prosecution also appealed it. Thankfully, he lost, and now he's actually for life. But if you think about it, you think about this gentleman here. Any of you know who this is? No?
Bernie Madoff.
Bernie Madoff, right. So Bernie Madoff, mastermind of the biggest Ponzi scheme ever, was sentenced to 150 years for essentially what? Nobody killed. $65 billion in fraud. And he didn't. And the judge in that case, Denny Chin, noted that 20 or 25 years would effectively be a life sentence. But he reasoned that the symbolism of the longer term was important given the enormity of the crimes. And now you think about $65 billion, you think about 12,273 lives. What does that mean? More recently, this woman here, the social affairs minister for the Khmer Rouge regime, who was one of five people on trial, was released. She was found to have Alzheimer's and released her family, and now she's living at home. So given the lack of justice, or the injustice that one observes in a situation like this, how can one really make sense of all this? I have to go back to the wisdom of my late mother, who was really an inspiration to me. And she saved 20 lives, right? The five kids that she saved, a boy and a girl, they are actually my children. And she believed in what goes around comes around, that essentially she was Buddhist. She believed that if you did evil, it would come back to you. And believed in karmic justice. And that even if you didn't have justice in this lifetime, perhaps in the next, the people who have done harm to you would be reborn cockroaches, for example. In a way, she was able to forgive the fact that justice hadn't been served in her life. And I think that for a lot of Cambodians, for the 14 million now living in Cambodia, that is probably the reason why they're able to go on with their lives without wanting revenge or vengeance all the time, without being totally dysfunctional as a result of what happened to them. And I would argue that this is probably one of the more powerful effects of that experience.
Thank you.
So I've talked long enough. Thank you very much. And I will be happy to take questions.